So in 99 we were married, two kids came, and by 2003 Laurie had asked me for a divorce. And a little bit of upbringing on my part was I didn't get that, I didn't understand it, because I was taught and raised that if you want something, go get it, work harder. Well, in this instance, no matter how hard I worked, I couldn't fix this. It really, really threw me for a loop. So I had to take some time off work, and I struggled with this one for a very long time. I struggled with this one, and I had a coworker who was a Christian who introduced me to Pastor Dallas. It was basically the crossroads of my life, because I couldn't fix this. I thought I was in charge of my own world, my own destiny. It was kind of like the crossroads. It was 2 years after the initial request for a divorce that we had separated. So we were legally separated in the I think February-ish of 2005. And we parted ways. Laurie went to GP, and in hindsight, what I would say is I was getting right with God, and Laurie was getting right with God. Both on different paths. Both on different paths. Well, not really. The destination was the same, but the Lord, in hindsight, was working with Laurie, and He was working with me. And to make a long story short, we had to learn how to trust each other again. Mm-hmm. We had to learn to co-parent. We had to learn that we were not enemies. We were actually on the same team. And we were heading in the same direction, but it took a while. It took 7 years. So in March 18th of 2012, we recommitted our vows at Family Worship Center here in Whitecourt. And it was all emotional, because I don't think there was a dry eye in the building, because it was 7 years of journeying, we'll call it. It was 7 years of ups, downs, wins, losses, struggles, victories. We were all over the map. It was a roller coaster. Well worth it. Because, and even today, I guess one of the highlights for me is I learned I can be a parent by myself. I can do life by myself, but I don't want to. I value Laurie. I see her work ethic. I see her commitment to her family. I see her compassion. I see in her all the things that I need to improve on. She works hard. She works hard, and she's very, very committed to her family, and I see that.
Don't make me cry.
I see it. So, can I do life on my own? Sure. Do I want to? No, not even close. We're better together. We learned that. We had 7 years of figuring life out, and I came to the place where I choose to be with her. I choose her, and I value her, and I see that I have a long way to go. I fall down every once in a while.
We all do.
And then I have to maybe go for take the dog for a walk and restructure and say what's important here. Mm-hmm. And it's Laurie. It's our family. It's our being together. The small things, we don't try and sweat. We don't sweat the small things because they're not important. Mm-hmm. You know, there's certain things that are very important, and we work together on that. We're raising teenagers, and I think we're somewhat being successful. We have great kids, and it's kind of the last however many years in a nutshell. The first 3 years, I'd say I didn't want Laurie to leave. And then I found out, okay, well, you know what? Then she wanted back. And I said, no, it's my pride. I think her and I lasted 7 years apart because of my pride. I was very prideful. I told her, I told you that I believed in maybe a temporary separation, but let's get back together. So it was my pride in hindsight that kept us apart for 7 years. I think the last 3 years, I was growing to trust her and all that, but I kept finding myself reminding God what we went through. Like I had to remind God what we went through. I think He was changing my heart very, very slowly. And I didn't want to let go in a weird way. I think I had to come to the realization that I had a big part of this. It was 50-50. It was not, our marriage did not fail because of one person. It failed because of two people. We have an equal part in this, and then we both have to come to a place where we both wanted this. I couldn't fix the marriage on my own. Laurie couldn't fix the marriage on her own. We both had to want it. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. My pride.
We both kind of wanted things at different times. Mm-hmm. So, like, following up on Mike, yeah, like in the beginning, when Mike started coming here, I thought he went from one extreme to the next to me. And I kept looking in the rearview mirror thinking, like, when is the old Mike coming back? And I was expecting that. So I initially was very leery of coming here. And then it wasn't until a bunch of, like, when we'd been separated for a bit, and then a bunch of, like, terrible stuff happened. And then, as most of the people here know, I ended up walking with Noah on my own. And that's what I'd say, like, that's what I'd like to say broke me. And where I came to the place where I just gave everything to God, because I realized you can't do it without Him. You can't. I'd like to think, even sometimes now, I think, you know, yeah, I'm good, but I'm like, why am I so stupid? I know I can't do this without Him. And same thing, I can't do this without Mike. And I always say, at the beginning, the grass was always greener somewhere else. And then I think it was Pastor Dallas a lot of people here walked with us from day one. Mm-hmm. And I think it was Pastor Dallas that said, you know, the grass is greener where you water it. So as hard as it was, and so many times in those 7 years when I just wanted to give up and think, you know what, if He really doesn't want me, it would just be so easy to just say fine. And when like the divorce papers were served, it would have been easy to just sign them and be like, okay. But I'll never forget, like, I told him, I'm like, I'm not, like, no, till death do us part. And then we laugh about it now, because he was saying, well, is that a threat? And I'm like, take it as you will. But, you know, till death do you part. And as hard as it was being there at home with the kids on my own, thinking, like, I could have, the bitterness could have just grown. And instead, I thought, you know what? No, I'm going to pray. And oh my God, did I ever pray? Like, you wouldn't believe. And yeah, just little by little, you'd see those little nuggets of where, you know, Mike would just all of a sudden, he'd stay with the kids and I'd watch a movie. And so it was those little pieces of hope that I just clung to. And eventually, I got him back.
And I remember we started building trust and family again. We started spending time together as a family. And I remember AJ was 12, and I had him in the car with me, and I was trying to be real with AJ. You know, I'm his dad, but I still have emotions. I still have struggles. So as part of me sharing my faith with him, I said, I'm struggling. And he says, with what, Dad? I said, I'm very nervous. I'm very scared, and I want your opinion on something. And he said, what was that? And I said, well, I'm thinking about asking your mom out. And he said, well, as a family? I'm like, no, just me and her. And he goes, on a date? I'm like, yeah. And he goes, she'll say yes. Yeah, she'll say yes. But it was nice to see the transition and the hope in the kids too. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because they didn't understand it. They didn't understand the two homes. They didn't understand what we were going through. And we didn't want to put the burden on them. So, mm-hmm. You know, we just encouraged them to pray and be real with God. Tell them your struggles. But we didn't want them to lose hope either, but we didn't want to give them false hope. He used that little boy, Noah, to break my heart. I don't treat him any different than any of my kids. I love him. He's my boy. I'll start crying. Here's a little boy that needed a dad, and the Lord's picking me. And I came to the place like, what an honor. I have the privilege of raising this boy.
Actually, before Mike asked me out on a date, he had started, when Noah was about two, he had started bringing Noah to his house because the kids were so confused, like, why doesn't Noah come to Daddy's? And so we just, you know, boo-pooed whatever they were trying to do. And then I remember when Noah had just turned four, so we hadn't even started dating again, and Mike asked me, because he goes, you know, why there's so many kids out there that don't have dads, and there's this little boy that doesn't have a dad. And he goes, I'd be honored if you'd let me adopt him. And this was even before we were dating again. So I just about fell off my chair. And then the fear in me, of course, came in, and like, cause he was mine. But then, yeah, once we renewed our vows, it was about a year later, the adoption was finalized. And we told Noah, not all the details, but we did tell him that Mike adopted him.
I would just say, take some time, get your thoughts right, because we're supposed to control every thought that comes in. Control, grab that thought and compare it to that of Christ, and either toss it or keep it, depending on if it's a good thought or not. If you're actually saying, I'm wanting out of this marriage, you've already made up your mind and you're watering the grass somewhere else. You're in a marriage, you have a covenant relationship with God, and so many people think, well, I'm till death do us part, right? It can be a good thing, it can be a great thing. Where are you going to water your grass? Mm-hmm. And
if you're putting all your energy into like somewhere else, or into the thought of, yes, like, because I, like we said, I'm the one that initially asked for it, because I thought, you know what, it would be a lot easier being apart. And I had my stubbornness at the beginning, and because of, like, it was what I knew as a child even. And it was easier to run away than to work on things, because that was the easy way out. And, you know, I'm going to hurt you before you can hurt me, because that's how life was, right? Everybody hurts you. But like Mike said, looking, like, taking those thoughts and thinking, you know what? This is our society now. It is so easy to give up. And telling the one that says, you know, I'm done, I want this to be done, I don't want to be in this marriage, to think, like, flip the shoes. How would you feel if you're at your most vulnerable state and you look at it, like, you look at it through Christ? How would Christ look at this? And when it is scary, like Mike said, when everybody, you compliment each other. My weaknesses are what I see in Mike's strengths, and sometimes it's scary. Thinking, like, you know, that's where I don't succeed very well. And it can be scary, and it can create some hostility, but to the one that is wanting to fight for the marriage, you can't lose by not giving up. Is if you just keep trying and trying and trying, like, what can you lose, right?
And I remind them it takes to pray for them. Pray for them, because what we do when we pray for a spouse, it softens our heart. It gets our attitudes and thoughts more like Christ. Like, we pray blessings on them. We pray, you know what I mean? We pray for our spouses. And it's easy to give up, but hang around. Choose your friends wisely too. Hang around with people that promote. Like, I try to stay away from the negativity. Like, if I could easily find people to support me in my decision. Yeah, she did this, she did that, you know, or Lori could find people that said, yeah, Mike was this, Mike was that, you know what, the marriage is over. They could find people to hang around like that and promote or to support your decision of divorce. And I would flip that and say, you know what, find people who value marriage. Find people who value marriage. And I know even my generation kind of struggles with marriage counseling, but this is that pride speaking. We have to remove the pride. Leave the pride at the door. Fight for your marriage. Marriage counseling, there's all sorts of valuable, just fantastic tools out there. I know we saw Pastor Dallas numerous times, and even one-on-one, two-on-one, it was just fantastic, because these are the people that value marriage. And that's what I would say, is value your marriage, because it's a gift. Start looking at it as a gift. If you start seeing a family as a burden, you're going to want out. It's your viewpoint, though. What your family is such a blessing. Value it as, don't see it as a burden. See it as a blessing. And then hang around people that support that. Does that make sense? Perseverance, it's worth it. I would say I've never been more content. Mm-hmm.
Our marriage is so much better than it ever could have been.
Because it's honestly, it's great to know that she's got my back and she knows that I have her back. You know, when the teens or whatever try to pit parents against parent, there's no question. I have Lori's back. She has my back, and it's a wonderful place to be. Are we perfect? No.
No.
But I think we have a lifetime to look forward to. I wouldn't want it any other way. We have a lifetime to look forward to of a continued growth. Mm-hmm. So,
and, you know, the whole it takes a village to raise a child, but in our story, it took a
church,
a village of this church.
Yeah.
For us. Like, we couldn't have done it without God and this and everybody here.
Family worship center, yeah. Is it a dirty, downright, difficult, absolute, brutal road to travel? Yes. Is it worth it? Yes. Absolutely. I would do it again.
I was sure by now, God, you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll pray.